Hello everyone, this is Professor McLean and this is the lecture, Why Do We Need Environmental Flows? Thinking about it, this really isn't a lecture that's even needed because obviously all of you have chosen to take this course because you recognize the need for eflows. But do indulge me so I can present a brief case for eflows that also aligns with the messages in the next lectures. First, eflows are an essential tool for water resource protection in the IWRM toolbox, and without them, water managers will not meet their resource management objectives. Think about the range of tools that managers apply to protect water resources. There are pollution prevention programs to regulate waste discharges and soil conservation programs to control inputs of sediments and associated contaminants. Water conservation programs are there to reduce wastage. Destructive fishing practices, like using poisons, are controlled through fishing rules and restrictions. And if resource units are especially valuable and vulnerable, they can also be designated as protected areas and set aside. But even if all of these and more tools are applied to water resources protection, there will still be a set of pressures, like over-abstraction and over-regulation, that water resources are not protected against. This is the purpose of eflows. Reflect for a moment on the definition of IWRM offered by the Global Water Partnership. Quote, IWRM is a process that promotes the coordinated development and management of water, land, and related resources in order to maximize the resultant economic and social welfare in an equitable manner without compromising the sustainability of vital ecosystems. Economic and social welfare cannot be maximized while at the same time protecting vital ecosystems unless you apply every tool in your toolbox. So let's begin with dams and the potential they have, as shown in the photo, to erase rivers. Obviously, a normally permanent river without water is no longer a river, and the ecological and related social impacts are a complete loss. This is the Hidroagoyan Dam in the Amazon area of Ecuador. It's a run-of-river dam that diverts 100% of the river's flow when the flow levels are equal to or below the design flows for hydropower. Remember the Constitution of Ecuador mentioned in the first lecture? This is not an image of protecting Mother Earth, and the threat of many more images like this is real. The map to the right shows the location of more than 150 planned dams in the Andean Amazon region. Note that we're talking about the Amazon here. I won't overdo it with statistics, but do know that the Amazon contains the most biologically diverse aquatic ecosystems in the world, and these headwater regions are of great importance as sources of nutrients and spawning grounds for some of the river's most commercially important species. Consequently, the dependence of downstream communities on the health of these headwater systems is enormous. But dams need not erase rivers to cause severe impacts on the health and services provided by aquatic ecosystems. Large alterations in the annual and interannual variability of the river flow regime can also have severe detrimental effects. This is the Flaming Gorge Dam and Reservoir on the Green River, a headwater tributary of the Colorado River in North America. The stored water is used for hydropower generation, irrigation, and recreation. In the plot, the blue line is the river's flow regime before construction of the dam, when gentle low flows dominated the winter months and the river grew to high and variable flows between April and August. After the dam was constructed, the flow regime became more uniform, thereby doubling wintertime flows when people needed hydropower to warm their homes and effectively erasing the summer high flows. This change in flow regime has negatively impacted the habitats of native species and altered other aspects of the downstream river ecosystem. We'll delve into the ecological and social consequences of these changes in more detail later in the course. But for now, note that severe alterations in the natural flow regime threaten the ability of riverine ecosystems to function at a sufficiently high level. This is because aquatic ecosystems are evolved and finely tuned to the natural variability of flows throughout the year. We'll explore these relationships in much more detail in units focused on the underlying science of eflows. But for now, be aware that many key ecological functions in river systems depend on variable flows. These include flows that create essential habitats, trigger and enable migrations related to key moments in the life history of organisms, think about spawning, and even protect river ecosystems from invasions of alien species. These ecological processes then provide a range of ecosystem services that people and their cultures will likely depend upon. This graphic on the left presents the four categories of ecosystem services defined during the Millennium Ecosystem Assessment, and on the right, related constituents of human well-being that they support. Take a moment to pause the video and study these relationships. The reading from which they come is also provided in the supplemental reading section for this unit. What you'll find will likely run deeper than what you've thought about in the past. So if any questions or reactions come up, please post them in the class discussion forum. So dam operations are a major target for eFlow's assessment and implementation, and there are many dams to be addressed. The World Register of Dams contains nearly 60,000 large dams, and there are millions of smaller dams worldwide. Of the referenced single-purpose dams in the register, about half are for irrigation and about 20% for hydropower. Others focus on water supply, flood protection, and other purposes. 17% of reference dams in the register are used for multiple purposes. The largest numbers of large dams are in China, followed in order by the USA, India, Japan, Brazil, and Canada. Other areas with numerous large dams include Eastern and Western Europe, Southern and Western Africa, and Australia. We'll learn in subsequent lectures and readings that there's great diversity in the approaches countries take to cope with impacts of these dams, but it's clear that there's a great deal to do in every setting. No region or country has gotten this right so far. And there are a large number of future dams planned around the world as well. This map shows nearly 4,000 planned large dams for hydropower alone. And if the proportion of hydropower dams to other types of dams in the World Register is any indication, the total number of planned large dams is likely 20,000 or more. Another important feature of this map is that the majority of planned dams is in developing countries. Focal areas include the entire length of the Andes from the Amazon to Tierra del Fuego in Argentina. They extend from Eastern Europe into Central Asia and all along the Himalayas. The Mekong Basin, another of the world's most biologically diverse systems, is experiencing a period of rapid dam building, and many other planned dams are sprinkled across Africa, including some of the continent's most environmentally sensitive basins. The past, present, and future of dam building is linked to the financial status of countries and also financial mechanisms of an increasingly globalized world. Regional and country demographics and governance systems also play a big role, including influencing the level of attention and care that will be devoted to applying principles of IWRM. To view the magnitude of our challenge another way, look at these recent analyses and projections of the proportions of global river volume impacted by fragmentation and flow regulation. You'll learn that these two impacts on river systems are closely linked by the common source of dams and impoundments. The future projections are sobering, with at least strong impacts on river connectivity of nearly 90% of river volume, and strong impacts on flow of about 50% of river volume. These figures relate to both the physical obstacles imposed by dams as well as the alteration of river flows caused by dam operation. But the need for eFlows is not only about dams. In countries where water demands are high relative to supply, such as those in orange and red in the map on the screen, people will find ways to collect or divert water from rivers, wetlands, and lakes, whether dams are present or not. We'll explore how eFlows can be applied in these settings without major control points like dams, when eFlows must be incorporated into management systems for many users collectively impacting water resources and related aquatic ecosystems. Without exaggerating the doom and gloom of flow impacts already leveled on aquatic ecosystems, I'd like to note the trend recorded in the Living Planet Index, which has been monitoring the population abundance of more than 3,000 populations of freshwater species for nearly 50 years. In that time, they've recorded an average 80% decline in population numbers, which should be shocking to you. While these declines are not solely attributed to flow alterations, flow is an essential element in halting and reversing these declines, so we've got our work cut out for us. And finally, I must mention the wild card of climate change, which injects additional uncertainty into the future of aquatic ecosystems and the ways in which eflows can be applied to protect them. The majority of recent research considering the relationships between eflows and climate change has focused on the challenges climate change will pose to eflow science and practice. Fundamental and continuing changes to the hydrological cycle challenge many of the conceptual and technical approaches we've taken to eflows thus far. But eflows and their objectives of protecting the ecological status and functions of aquatic ecosystems should also be considered among the measures to support resilience and adaptability in aquatic ecosystems. This is also among the messages of the Brisbane Declaration 2.0, but it's a topic of very little research so far, and it needs more attention. So what are the take-home messages in this lecture, Why Do We Need Environmental Flows? Well, first, we need eflows because they're an essential tool in the IWRM toolbox, and water resource managers are not going to achieve their objectives unless they include them. This is because aquatic ecosystems are under intense pressure from altered flow regimes, mainly due to dams and water overabstractions. And these alterations negatively impact a range of ecological processes and the related services they provide to human communities. Take home the message that the global trend is toward increasingly severe impacts on aquatic ecosystems. There's a lot to do, and we need to act quickly. That's the end of this lecture. Thank you very much.